The challenge, of course, for a writer that has such a tale to tell, such a historical epic tale to tell, is how to weave that into the novel form.
Yes.
And quintessentially to be a storyteller.
Yes.
Which I think you do marvellously. And it comes alive with our African protagonists. And first their journey to get the seeds.
The sheshi beans.
The sheshi beans.
Yes.
And then the capture and escape. I mean, how did you wrestle with the fact that, you know, this could have easily been a history book? And said, look, no, it's not a history book, it's a novel. I need to form characters, believable characters.
Yes, that's right.
That are going to move people.
I think the thing is, you should understand that most people learn history through novels.
Yeah.
Very few of us remember history from school. Mm. But most, if you go to any pub and you start talking to people about some historical fact, it'll be something they've learned in some novel.
Yes.
And I thought, well, the novel's a great teaching method.
Yes.
Isn't it about time we took the most unpalatable story in British history
it is, yes.
to make it palatable.
Yes.
And I did a variety of devices in there. Right. But in trying to do that, I thought, it's much better to actually create families. I remembered Roots. I remember Alex Haley when he wrote Roots. He was talking about one particular family.
Yes.
Which he traced back to Guinea, coast of Guinea,
yes.
and traced them going back to America, and I remember in 1970 something, early 70s, the Sunday Times came out with Alex Haley said his family was on this, his ancestor was on this particular boat in 1721 in the Port of London. That is not the case. Mm-hmm. You know, they wanted to deny it. And I thought, that's really sad. I didn't want that to happen to my book. They've missed the point completely.
There's a bigger narrative.
There's a much bigger narrative. So I thought, well, I'm not going to have that with my book. Yes. I won't trace a family. We know what happened, basically. Now I want.
And we know that there are descendants.
Absolutely. And I want the next generation of black and white kids to have the story. Start off with the story, not with my generation, where we were starting to look for bits and pieces. Where was the story? What was the story of the slave trade? So I thought, let me put it together in one story, where I put the business on the panorama of the business of slavery, and on the foreground, there's this story about individual slaves, England individual white families, and good and bad on both sides.
Yes, it is very moving, and when you talk about. You talk about the wretched slave owner and the overseer, the brutal overseer, and yet the slave owner has a daughter who falls madly in love.
Yeah.
I know we shouldn't be telling too much of the story because we want people to read the book, but I guess that even in the most wretched situations, love blossoms.
Yeah.
In the most extraordinary places.
Extraordinary places, and. In that, what I was doing with her was telling a story of something that actually happened, I know of, in particular, several times.
And you know, it's funny, when I got to that part, my instinct was, oh gosh, here we go. My assumption, thankfully very wrong, was that the black slave, the black man enslaved, would fall madly in love with the overseer's daughter, but you turn that on its head somewhat in a very clever device, in as much as that as she was clearly enamoured with him, and he respected her,
yes,
but never for a second looked up to her. I mean, it was a very balancing, a high wire act.
Well,
to get that right.
Well, I was thinking. It'd be very difficult for him to reject it flatly out of hand because he's in a very dangerous situation. His life is always at stake when on the plantation.
Yes.
The black man and the black woman's life was always at stake.
Yes.
And therefore, it'd be very, very difficult for him to suddenly say, no, And yet he's got to think of escaping. I mean, either of us. Listen, the moment when I went to the Caribbean, I did quite a lot of research in the Caribbean. When I went to some of the plantations there, and I went to one particular one, where there's some enormously brutal things happen, and the family have actually kept the records, and I had the records. I had access to the records. Yes. The government of Barbados allowed me access to the records.
Okay.
And then when I saw this, and I just saw the absolute brutality,
yes,
I realized that we still got to tell a story past the brutality. Because it doesn't matter how, like, you know, in the Holocaust, the Jewish community, they tell the story of what happened in the camps.
Yes.
Lots of times.
Brutal as it is.
And they'll
uncomfortable
find,
as it seems.
Uncomfortable as it seems. That's right. And they'll find love and affection and things like in the camps. Well, the Holocaust is one thing. The Black Holocaust, the slave trade, was much larger.
Was much, much bigger.
Went over a period of 400 years.
Yes.
I mean, I'm not saying for any moment that what the Jewish community went through was nothing. No. What they went through was terrible.
Yes,
was
yes,
without question was terrible.
Yes.
And I'm not comparing, but I'm just sort of saying here is a story
within itself.
That's right.
It's a story that needs to be told, and it's uncomfortable.
It's very uncomfortable. Lasted over a long period of time.
Yes.
A lot of people still feel guilty about it. A lot of English people still feel guilty about it, and unnecessarily in my view. A lot of Africans ignore it, but do not want to hear about it, do not want to talk about it, because they don't want to face up to it, and they will have to.
Yeah.
And a lot of West Indians, I still feel, a lot of my West Indian friends still fairly feel angry about it, and they shouldn't be,
okay,
because they weren't slaves.
Yes.
The white man was not a slaver,
yes, yes,
neither was the African today. We are the inheritors of a bad legacy,
but
which we must
that,
turn on its head and into something good.
And you do that. You do that with the spirit of our protagonist, the hero and heroine.
Yes.
I mean, this is not just about Kunta Kinte.
No,
there's a fantastic woman in this too.
Well, women have been forgotten in a lot of...
But you haven't forgotten them at all.
No, not at all.
They play a central role.
Very central with me, because I believe that women played a central role throughout slavery, throughout history. Even in Britain, they played major roles. What happened to English historians, in my view, is that they've forgotten to write the women's roles.
Okay.
And they've not... women didn't have for a long time access to be able to write their own roles.
Okay.
And I don't want to make that mistake in book I write. So women are central. They're half the book.
Sure.
As they are half of the human race. They are half of anything I ever write.
But it's not women. Forced. I mean, you just... You know,
I want to do that.
You want to do it, and you want to make them believable. Good heavens, she suffers.
Well, what happens when a woman suffers, especially a woman with a child suffers, she becomes a very tough, irresolute individual.
Mm-hmm.
Now, that woman suffered again and again and again.
Again and again.
By the time she got to the Caribbean, she was tougher than the man.
Yeah.
I mean, when Coyote was saying, why don't we do, and it would be something fairly mild, she said, no, why don't we go all the way and do this? And it was something much nastier.
Yes.
That was it. And I didn't write it because I wanted to make women feel good. Not at all. I wrote it because that's what I believed would have happened.
Okay.
That was my interpretation.
As a necessity. That you know, it's not about looking after the kids, it's about people taking their roles, and that could have been a man or a woman. In this case, it was both.
That's right, but the black woman wasn't just protecting the kids.
No.
The black woman was protecting the black family.
That's right, yes.
She much more so than even the black man.
Yes.
And therefore, she would be obviously tougher. She would be obviously far more ruthless when it came to carrying out acts like a shabby carried out.
Yes, yes, yes. So, I mean, I guess you've given your life to this. I mean, would you say? I mean, it is an epic saga.
Well, I'd like to say that, first of all, any black writer or white writer could have written this. Nothing clever in it at all. I think any of us could have written it, but you would have to have one thing, that's the utter dedication and commitment.
Yeah.
And I think anybody who's got that, and I had that, once I'd finished one job, I decided I was going to put... The next 10 years, I said to my children, they said to me, how long is it going to take? I said, 10 years. It took me 14.
Wow.
There was 2 years travelling
down
the West African coast, around Britain and around the Caribbean in some real old tramp steamers, which was fun. And then 2 years living in the British Library. working day all the time, from the time it opened to the time it closed. I was there for 2 years, and then 8 years writing,
nine years writing,
and then a year editing with, well, it was me editing with my editor, Honor Boric, who, fabulous editor, fabulous woman.
How did you feel, now, you give up your life, you put your life on hold to write this novel, and a lot of people think they can write, a lot of people, you know, would like to write, and you did all the groundwork, I guess three continents, as you said, in the library from sunup to sundown, and then you finish the book, and then your editor reads it, and your friends and family read it, and they put it down and look at you and say, "It's a brilliant book."
Yes, I did say that.
I mean, how does that feel? Because, you know, I mean, writing is one thing, delivering is something else. And so, how did that feel after?
It brought tears to my eyes, because, you know, it's like firing. Doing a trilogy like this is like firing an arrow at the Empire State Building, and 14 years later you hit the Empire State Building itself, you know? And it's
bullseye.
And it's a surprise, because, as you know, writing books is great risks. Mm-hmm. It's a risk that you'll find a story. It's a risk that the story is something that is good enough. And it's a risk that you'll be able to write it.
That's right.
And then once you've done all that, you've finished it, then it's a risk you'll find a publisher.
That's right.
You know? And when you do find a publisher, and he says, okay, fine, it's a risk that, that once it's published, that the reviewers will review it, or anybody will read it. It's a huge risk, all the way through. But I knew that at the beginning.
And do you always feel, gosh, you know, what am I doing this to myself? I'm putting myself on the line again and again and again and again.
Now, every time I did that, I used to remember some... There's three Caribbean guys and four Nigerians from different parts of Nigeria. We used to hang around together in the 60s.
Yeah.
And every single, we had a dream together. And all of them have done some great things around the world since then.
Okay.
And we had a dream. And we all dreamt. We're going to write this book. One of us is going to write this book.
Okay.
And so when I look back and think, the book is actually alive. I think back in those days, and then my tribute is to them.
Is it?
That they, yes, because they gave me the fortitude, and when I was writing it, they were phoning me up.
Is that right?
They carried me all the way through. Yes. The team I had, I started off with a team of 12 people,
right.
And one died, and I've got 11. And those 12, those 11 now, took me through everything.
Gosh.
When I cried, when it hurt, they were there.
I bet. Now, having done it now, I mean, that and knowing that it's good, I mean, you know, I guess
you're very kind. Thank you.
You put it out there.
Thank you.
But I guess one of the last challenges is to ensure that the book gets recognition on the different levels.
Yes.
That we've talked about. I mean, it's funny that I was thinking about what questions I would ask. In the week, and I was fortunate enough to be at Westminster to see Barack Obama. And he spoke about his grandfather in Kenya.
Mm.
Who he was very gracious, because he could have said to the British establishment that my grandfather was tortured by the British.
Yes.
But instead of that, he said my grandfather served tea.
Yes.
To the British.
Yes. Well, that says everyone.
Says it all. You don't need to. You don't need to ram it down your
throat. I don't think you need to ram things down people's throats. Really.
To make the point.
No, not really.
But two rows in front of me, I was a guest of the American Embassy, and I thought, and I was in front of Tom Hanks, and I was nearly bold enough to say, "Tom, I just read this novel, and I want you to take it to Steven Spielberg, because he has to make a film of it." I mean, I just think that it lends itself to the likes of Spielberg with the great African American actors and British
black actors.
Who I'm sure would be fighting over.
Oh, we have some great actors in this country.
We've got quite
a few male and female, both in the Caribbean community and the African community. We've got some great actors, and they'd be fantastic for that.
So, who's the African American director? Spike Lee. Maybe he'd be fighting Spielberg. To direct this.
Well, this could be fun. I mean, I think it's still got. I think it's got a long life. This one, and I don't think it's because I wrote it. I think it's got a long life because I think the community is here.
How are we going to get it on the big screen? Because I guess this story needs to be told to a wide audience, doesn't it?
I agree. I think it has to go. I think this has got to be a book for schools, abridged, of course, because there's violence and there's sexuality in there, where, you know, educationists would need to pare it back, because you know there's only they know what, and I'd be happy for that, because educationists would know how far to let things go, because they're in education. I think it'd be very good for a TV series or film. I think it'll make that. With the help of people like yourself and a number of other people who are pushing it for that. And I suspect that somebody like you, Simon, will be quite influential with it. And because, you know, it is a story that you can do a lot with.
Yes.
And given that, given the intention of your organisation, it actually fits. It dovetails.
I have to say that I do have ulterior motives.
Yes.
Because I want to educate. I want to educate Black Britain, but also wider Britain too.
Yeah, you've got to. You have to. Both sides.
And this story tells that.
Well, I think it's important that we have a lot of. I mean, I have a lot of most of my nephews. No, most of the children of my family, in the family, are nieces, most of them.
Yes.
And there were a lot of women in our family, majority of our family are women.
Yes.
And therefore we need to have something very strongly for young Black women.
Yes.
Very, very important, because they are very talented. They're so talented. The young Black men are very, very talented as well. And I don't think they're either getting the break, but I think young women are being forgotten. There's some things that there's extra things they have to go through. We men don't.
No, sure. And I wanted to ask, I forgot to ask at the beginning, reap the forgotten harvest. I mean, where did you get that? Where did you get it from? It's very poignant.
Everything that every individual, nation, community has to reap the forgotten harvest. It's really to
what do. You mean by that?
It's to do that you've forgotten. To do that you've, or to go and undo something you shouldn't have done. It's to make better the past.
Okay, make better the past. I like that.
And of course, to do it without guilt.
Of course.
See, the strongest ally I had within my team. Yes. This, I have four whites in my team, four English people, and they're blood brothers to me and sisters, because they've been with me 30 years.
Yes.
And they are very, very, they're much rooting for something that includes them, that also says to them, this isn't about guilt.
Okay.
And that's what we're I'm trying to get across to England.
Okay.
This isn't about guilt or anger.
No.
This is just a story. That happened to people. Mm-hmm. I've peeled back some curtains to let you see the amazing panorama before you of what happened between us. And that's what happens. So if a Martian lands in England today, and he wrote, and he said, what happened? Well, how did all these Black and white people come to be here? If he read these three books, he'd know.
And I guess harvest, when you think of harvest, it's the lifeblood.
It's the lifeblood.
Of a community.
Absolutely.
And you want to revisit that lifeblood that rejuvenates all communities.
Absolutely. Without being academic about it, intellectual about it, or guilt-making about it. I think, this is 2011.
Yeah.
I came here in 53. And in 1953, the guilt was very high.
Right.
Therefore, the word slavery was hardly even used.
Yes,
now people use it because it happened, And in a few years' time, our kids will just be bandying it about because we want our children not to have the problems with this story we my generation had.
Well, it's a brilliant book written by a very special man. And thank you for giving your time to me, to the organisation, and to our communities. We'd like to have you back with book two and book three and the film premiere at Cannes. Sometime soon.
Thank you, Simon. You've been very, very kind, and thank you very, very much. Because I think it's something I hope it becomes a contribution to England.